Christ Our Redeemer Lutheran Church in Sandpoint, Idaho. It's Palm Sunday, the day in which we remember and give thanks for Jesus going into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey while the people gathered for this parade, waved palm branches, and shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" A day of celebration, because little did they know just what Jesus would do to show us that he is the King and Lord of all by the end of this Holy Week. Have a challenge for you this morning. For those of you who received my email, I encourage you to gather up palm branches if you have any, or a branch or something green, a fern, whatever, and be prepared to wave it during both the opening and closing songs during today's worship. So I'll give you a minute to do that as we also share some other announcements. Oh, forgot one thing. If you could take a picture of your family doing that and share it on the comments section on this Facebook Live broadcast this morning, that would be awesome. I'd ask Brad, our congregation president, to step forward with a few things he would like to share today.
Good morning, everybody. Good to see you again. I have a couple of announcements for you. First one is very, very important, okay? Prayer requests. We don't want to get away from prayer requests just because we've gone to online services. So if you have a prayer request, we ask that you send it in either email or you can call the church. If you go to www.coresandpoint.org, you will find our email address and our phone number, and you can send in your prayer request. We want to make sure that we get those out there to everybody. Also, too, we wanted to thank you for your generosity in sending in your free will offering. We really appreciate it. Just because we're not meeting face-to-face doesn't mean that our bills have gone away. We've still got water, electric, gas, payroll. They also come in every month. And we need to make those bills and payments on time so that we can keep engaging people, connecting generations, and building relationships in Christ. Your free will offering, if you are able, we understand that these are tough times. If you cannot, that is fine. We understand completely. If you can, please send in your free will offering. As you know, our mission here at CORE, Christ Our Redeemer Lutheran Church, is to engage people, connect generations, and build relationships in Christ. Our online services are going out all across the country. So we're not only reaching out past Sandpoint, but also past Idaho. We're actually getting coast to coast. So we ask you to please forward the link to our services to all your friends and family. I'd like to thank Pastor and Kesson and Kenzie for putting this all together, Colleen and John for helping us out here. If you look, last week's service had over 980 views. 980 views. We couldn't even fit 980 people in this church. So that is just a fantastic thing. Before last week's service, I forwarded it out to my entire contact list, okay? And as you saw, if you saw last week's service, I made a joke about how the camera adds 10 pounds. Well, I just wanted to share something with you because three of my college roommates emailed me back after watching the service. And so my first roommate, Dave, he commented on my joke there about the camera adding 10 pounds and I'm really not this fat. Dave wrote to me, "Hey Brad, time for a salad." My other roommate, Terrence, great friend of mine, and these guys I haven't seen in 20 years, you know. Terrence wrote, "Brad, you are glowing, when are you due?" And the oldest roommate, my roommate Jeff, said, "Thanks, Brad. I always wanted to see what a shaved Sasquatch looked like." So I don't come from a very sensitive group, but we got to keep smiling in these times and keep praising the Lord. Of course, I have to say, hi, Mom. You know, I love you. And we cannot wait to see you in person when all of this is over, because as you know, me and Pastor are much better looking in person. Thank you very much.
How do I follow that? Instead of me following it, Kenzie, if you'd please step forward with some more good news and some great things to share today.
I don't know how to follow that either. Thanks, Brad. I will start by saying, hi, Mom. My mom is also watching from the great state of Minnesota. And if you are on our Facebook page, whether you got here through Facebook or our website, you're in the right place for all things Christ our Redeemer. This is where we're going to post our updates and our announcements. And you will probably also get those in your email. So if you're not a Facebook user, make sure you're checking your email. The second thing is thank you to everybody who donated Easter eggs and candy. Even though we didn't get to have our 10,000 Easter egg hunt like we wanted, we did get to take those eggs and put them in some tote bags, leave them on the curb, and let community members take them. We had 100 bags, and they were gone in a half an hour. So if you gave Easter eggs, thank you. And if you came to get an Easter egg bag, thank you also. If you have your Easter egg hunt, which I hope you do, please tag us and show us the fun that you're having. That's all. Thank you.
Two more things that I'd like to share quickly. A reminder, this Tuesday, April 7th, beginning at 11 a.m., we are partnering with Second Harvest out of Spokane, an emergency food distribution. There will be enough for 250 households. So that will be taking place here at Christ Our Redeemer, 11 o'clock this Tuesday morning, April 7th. And then also a personal invitation. This is Holy Week, a chance for us to prepare for Jesus' crucifixion and his resurrection. I'd like to personally invite you to take part in our online worship services that will be taking place over this week. This Thursday is Maundy Thursday, that mandate that God gave us to love one another as I have loved you. That service will be on at 6:30 p.m. Pacific time this Thursday evening. Good Friday will be a tenebrae service, a service of darkness, but it's not all darkness. We'll have the candles here in front. We'll be remembering the words of Jesus as we gather as one, even though we're not in this building, but as we gather as one to celebrate and remember Jesus' death for us. 6:30 p.m. Pacific time on Friday. And then I think you know what next Sunday is as well. Easter morning. It'll be a little different without everyone here, but we are still a community, even as we worship online together. That will be at 10 a.m. Pacific time next Sunday, April 12th, as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's go ahead and begin this time of worship with the Lord with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, on this Palm Sunday morning, we remember and give thanks for the way in which you showed your humbleness, your humility, in coming into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey. I mean, how much more humble can you get than that? The King of Glory shows your love for us. Lord, in this time of Palm Sunday worship, we ask for your blessing, and that together we could raise palm branches or whatever branches or greenery we have together as we worship you as our Lord and King. We ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. We begin with our opening song. For those of you that have printed off the worship service, you can read it there. Or hopefully, I noticed we're at a little lower resolution this morning, but hopefully you'll still be able to read it from the screen behind me. All glory, laud, and honor.
Ring. You are the King of Israel, and
And our sin, we lay it at the foot of the cross and receive from our Lord that forgiveness, that life, that kingly glory that comes to us through our Lord Jesus Christ. We continue with the invocation as it's printed in your service folder and as you can see it behind me. We gather this morning in the house of God as his dearly loved children, and we are reminded that we were baptized for this moment and forever in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We have seen his glory. Glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. We have peace in knowing the humble way in which our Lord came into our world. Let us consider our unworthiness for such a great gift and confess before God and one another our great need of the forgiveness and life that he brings us in love. A moment of silence to consider our brokenness and a God who forgives us. Heavenly Father, we confess to you that we have sinned against you in many ways, some of which we are aware, and some of which we did not even recognize. Forgive us, Father, not because we are worthy, but because we trust in the promises you have made to us in your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. God has been faithful to us in the past, and God will be faithful in the future. But we are grateful that God is faithful now. His promise to us is that if we confess our sins, he hears and forgives so that we may be assured and comforted in our hearts. Upon this, your confession, I announce the grace of God to all of you. Your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. We turn our attention to the reading of God's Word.
Our Old Testament lesson is found in Zechariah chapter 9, verses 9 through 12. Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim, and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will free your prisoners from the waterless pit. Return to your fortress, you prisoners of hope. Even now I announce that I will restore twice as much to you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle lesson is found in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Palm Sunday Gospel reading comes to us from Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here shortly.'" They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing, untying that colt?" They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks around it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David! Hosanna in the highest!" This is the gospel of the Lord.
Grace to you, O Christ.
We confess together our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. You'll find it both in your service folder and also behind me.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We continue with the next song as it's printed in your folder, and also as you'll see it behind me, hopefully, Forever. Events of Palm Sunday, it's easy to wonder, what in the world does a donkey have to do with anything? Help us to see that that donkey was an important part of your overall plan, a plan to bring us life, peace, and hope that lasts forever. We ask and thank you for those blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. You remind me of a donkey. I know, that's probably not a very wise way to start a message. I'm not commenting on how stubborn you might be, or about any of your looks, or even your singing ability, or lack thereof. Now, if you're thinking this morning, Pastor, that's a really stupid idea. The donkey, it's not what Palm Sunday is about. It's about the man who rides in on the donkey. Yeah, I do get that. If we focus too much on the donkey, we're going to miss the main point of Palm Sunday. But for the first time in all of my years of ministry, I noticed that of the 10 verses that are given in Mark chapter 11 to the Palm Sunday account, 7 of them focus, on this donkey. And then finally at the end of verse 7, you get Jesus sitting on a donkey. But 7 of those 10 verses remind us and focus on making us know that a donkey was part of this, and that donkey was quite important. Now you might begin by asking, okay, why in the world would Jesus ride into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey? Jesus walked everywhere he went around Judea and Galilee. And now all of a sudden, he's riding on a donkey. Well, by doing this, Jesus identified himself as the promised Savior, as our Messiah. 500 years earlier, the prophet Zechariah had prophesied that the King, the Savior, would ride into Jerusalem on a donkey. You heard it in today's Old Testament lesson. See, your King comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So, riding into Jerusalem identified Jesus as the promised Savior. And second, this also looks back to King Solomon from the Old Testament. When he was about to be anointed, set apart as Israel's next king, his father David said, "Put Solomon, my son, on my own mule." So he rides into the city on the back of a donkey. And third, this tells us that Jesus came in peace. Back in the day, generals of conquering armies would usually ride into the city on the back of this huge white horse, a great steed. That was a sign of their strength. I am your conqueror. But yet even other kings in history would choose to ride into a conquered city on the back of a donkey, saying, "I'm coming not to destroy, but in peace." And finally, Jesus makes clear that this donkey, whom he had already spotted in town, to be one that had never been ridden before. And that's actually something very significant. The donkey was like a sacrifice that would be given in a temple. Back in Jesus' day, when you raised an animal to be a sacrifice in the temple, it could not be used for any other purpose. It was just raised to be a sacrifice. This donkey then had no other function in life than to be the animal that Jesus would ride on when he entered into Jerusalem. This was literally the high point of its life. So the donkey was actually a great choice of an animal for Jesus to ride in on. Okay, let's get back to you reminding me of a donkey. Obviously, there are some downsides to this. They are beasts of burden. If you've ever looked directly into the eyes of a donkey, they look so tired. I think of you when I look into the eyes of a donkey. Overworked, carrying more burdens than you really should be. Tired of the changes, the fear, the uncertainties, the unknowns in the midst of this coronavirus pandemic. Not knowing from one day to the next what's going to change. When Jesus looks into eyes like that, he says, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." This Palm Sunday donkey was also tied up. Back in Jesus' day, your donkey, it was your top, most prized possession. Donkeys would carry water and other goods that you would trade. A donkey would plow your field. So this donkey was tied up, tied to its work, tied to what had to be done. In many ways, we also are tied to our work, to chores. Lately, it's been a lot to fear, to whatever it is you have to face today. At times, our lives can become almost routine, although that has certainly changed lately, almost boring, drudgery. It's like singing the same song over and over and over again. And it becomes difficult. Sometimes, I think some of us are living the life of a very heavily burdened donkey. I don't know if you can see this at home, but it's a donkey whose feet are way up in the air with an overloaded cart right behind it. This kind of life, it's just not pretty. But there is another side to the life of a donkey and to our life stories as well. Palm Sunday is such a rich day for followers of Jesus. You see, your life is meant to be so much more than just a bunch of drudgery or carrying an overload of burdens. The burden that that Palm Sunday donkey would carry would also be our source of life and of hope. That Palm Sunday donkey was a vehicle that would be used by our Lord Jesus. It was a means of transportation that would take our Savior into the hearts of millions of Christians. So today, you do remind me of that Palm Sunday donkey in many ways. Just as Jesus took something ordinary and made it something so very special, he takes your regular life and he can bring it joy and meaning. Jesus has this incredible gift of taking ordinary things and turning them into something absolutely extraordinary. Jesus takes an ordinary boat floating out on the Sea of Galilee, and he turns it into a pulpit where he shares the good news of the kingdom. He takes a little bit of dirt from the ground, he spits into it, and then spreads it across this blind man's eyes, and he gives him back his sight. He takes one boy's little tiny sack lunch, and he uses it to feed 5,000 people. Jesus takes a borrowed tomb from Joseph of Arimathea, and he turns it into a place where he is brought back to life. You see, Jesus can take your ordinary life and fill it full of meaning. You are loved by him unconditionally. He loves you enough to give up his very life for you. Jesus takes you as you are, looking like an overburdened, over-the-top donkey with feet up in the air, and brings you rest, joy, and peace. You remind me of a Palm Sunday donkey because the most important thing you will ever do is bear Jesus Christ. You are a Christian. You bear his name. When you were baptized, the sign of the cross was placed upon you. You now carry that cross on behalf of Jesus himself. You carry his message, his good news. The most important thing that you are called to do in life, because it has this eternal dimension to it, is to share in your own words what Jesus Christ means to you. There's actually this wonderful legend about donkeys, and I hope you can see this at home. Many of them now bear a cross on their back. You can't always see it because it is embedded fairly deep inside their coat. The legend states that following Palm Sunday, the donkey was returned to its owner, but for whatever reason, it broke away from its owner. It found its way in the procession that led to Calvary and followed Jesus to the cross, but it just could not bear to watch Jesus being crucified there. So there, under the shadow of the cross, it got a cross on its back and shoulders. And so, the legend goes, the shadow of the cross marks the donkey as a testimony to our dying Savior. We are called to share Jesus in our acts of love, or in our language, with our children, grandchildren, friends, and our neighbors. A ninth grade student by the name of Jake Janosek had been adopted from an orphanage in Guatemala. When the children in that orphanage were told that their new parents were coming to pick them up and take them to their new home, first, they would take them to the local Burger King for a special treat. They would then have this Burger King crown put on their head as a sign that they were about to be adopted into a new family. Because of some legal issues, his family, his new parents, were a bit delayed in getting there. But they still took Jake to that local Burger King. He proudly wore that crown, patiently waiting for his parents to arrive. As he later shared this story with the congregation he was in on the day he was confirmed, he put on that crown to talk about how he had been welcomed into a new family, God's family. Jesus wants to welcome us again and again into that special family. And as Jake shared that story, he was doing what was one of the most important things he would ever do. He shared the difference that Jesus made to him personally. If you've ever become bored with your life, if you feel like your life has just become drudgery and one burden after another, challenge for you. Consider taking some time to share your faith with someone else. It's actually a very healthy thing to do when you're down or you just seem to be focused on how hard or unpredictable or even how fearful life has become. By sharing how Jesus has made an eternal difference in your life with someone you care about, it can actually refocus your faith on how God is still active, how he's still loving you, and how he is, even to this day, walking with you through the ups and the downs you're facing right now. Sharing that could also potentially help lead someone else to Jesus and his love for all people. I also find it amazing that the disciples told the owner of the donkey, "The Lord needs it." I mean, this is Jesus Christ, the Lord of the universe, the Son of God, the Savior of all, and he needs a donkey. How much more humble do you want to get than that? Today, Jesus is saying, "I need you." Imagine that. He has no other plans for saving humanity. The only plan that he has is having people like you and like me show his power and love and to share his good news with others. Now, if you're not a talker, you can still do it by loving others, by being kind, gentle, and caring, or simply just being there for people who need to see the love of Jesus reflecting through you to them. So what is that message of love we share? The same one who chose to ride into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey is indeed the ultimate King of Glory. He didn't need a mighty war horse to show his power and strength. Instead, he takes the simple, the unusual things of this world, the things that people might glance right past or just ignore, and he uses them to change all of history. This heavenly king would himself carry a huge burden himself. He would endure a mockery of a trial, false accusations, a false conviction, beatings, dragging his own cross up and down the cobblestone streets of Jerusalem, nails piercing his hands and his feet, dying like a convicted criminal. Now, why would he tolerate something like that? Because he cares that deeply about you and about me. He knows your burdens. He knows that you would be lost and without hope had he, the humble King of all, not taken your place on the cross. He came to serve the Lord and to serve you by giving up his life in your place. That's what this upcoming Holy Week is all about. Oh, but we know, his death is not the end of the story. We know what awaits next Sunday. Easter, resurrection, life to the full, the burden of sin and brokenness being shattered, broken forever. Hope, joy, and peace that are yours and mine forever. So on this Palm Sunday, the opportunity for you and me is to, well, be more like the donkey. Bear his love, carry him. Look for opportunities to carry Jesus into a room or a relationship. He can take drudgery, fear, and uncertainty and turn it into blessings. That's the secret of the Palm Sunday donkey, and it's a way of life for you and me as children of God. In Jesus' name, amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all of our human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the true faith of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We continue with our next song, Our God.
Awesome in power. of us, then what could stand against it? If our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? Then if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God, our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Stop us, and if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against?
We continue as we take the thoughts, the concerns, the things that are on our mind on this Palm Sunday morning and take it to our Lord in prayer. Let's go to our Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, you showed us your humility, your humbleness as you rode into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey. Who would have ever thought it? Lord, help us to be humble, to be gentle as we share the story of Jesus with our family, with our friends, our neighbors, and those in our midst who need to hear the saving message of your love for us. On this Palm Sunday, even as we're not gathered in one building, and we gather as a community scattered around, help us to reflect that Palm Sunday love in all that we say and that we do. Heavenly Father, in the midst of this coronavirus pandemic, we pray that you would bring peace to our hearts and minds, which can be torn right now with everything that's going on, Lord. Help us to focus on your love for us, on the fact that you've got this in your hands. Lord, we especially pray that you would be with the first responders, fire, police, ambulance, and in particular with our healthcare workers, doctors and nurses who are doing everything they can, putting their lives at risk to bring health and healing in due time. Protect them. Enable them to use the gifts that you've given them to make a difference in the lives of those who are struggling and are at a loss at this time. Heavenly Father, help us to remain focused on our mission to connect people to Jesus, to engage people, to connect generations, to build relationships in Christ, even in this highly strange and unusual Lenten season. And Lord, as we look ahead to Holy Week, Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and the celebration of Easter, keep our hearts and minds focused on what you have done and continue to do for us as your children. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the great success for the Easter egg hunt kits, which enabled people in this community to have an at-home Easter egg hunt with their families. We pray that you continue to work through us to find creative ways to stay connected in this unusual time, ways that are safe, that follow guidelines and regulations, but that continue to show our love for people, relationships, and again, in this just unusual time, to give us strength to move forward. We ask that you would both bless and protect those who will be here for the second harvest distribution this Tuesday morning. Lord, in a time where there are great needs, help this to be an opportunity to connect with this community and with people who are in need of food. And Heavenly Father, we bring Christ our Redeemer, our little lambs, preschool, pre-K, and kindergarten before you, and when it eventually returns, our children's church, adult Bible class opportunities, and Lord, that community outreach that you've embedded in our DNA as a congregation. Help that to be something that will help us to not only grow, but to go. We bring these prayers before you as we join in the prayer that you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We receive the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord lift up his countenance, his personal and abiding presence among you, and give you his peace. Amen. Okay, time for the challenge. Our closing song is one of my favorites. I remember even as a child that we would always process in with palms during this particular song. Hosanna, loud Hosanna, sing it loud and clear and raising palm branches as you have them at home. Who knows, we might have a few palm branches wandering through in the background as we sing this together. Hosanna, loud Hosanna.
Hosanna, loud Hosanna, the little children sing through pillar, court, and temple. The lovely anthem bring to Jesus who had blessed them, close folded his breast. The children sang their praises, the simplest and the best. From all event they followed in an exultant crowd, the victor palm branch waving and chanting clear and loud. The Lord of earth and heaven rode on in lowly state, nor scorn that little children should on his bidding wait. Hosanna in the highest, that ancient song we sing, for Christ is our Redeemer, the Lord of heaven our King. Oh, may we ever praise him with heart and life and voice, and in his blissful presence eternally rejoice.
How could we not be filled with joy, with hope, as we shouted together, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. It's that Palm Sunday joy, that Palm Sunday peace that we have as followers of Jesus. But the story doesn't end there, because we know what's coming. I'd invite you again to join us on Monday, Thursday evening, this Thursday at 6:30 p.m. Pacific time, as we remember Jesus' mandate, his command, and also his opportunity to us to love one another as he has loved us. Good Friday evening, 6:30 p.m., the service of tenebrae, a service of darkness, but a service that ends with hope as we see that singular lit Christ candle, as you see behind me here on the screen as well. It's not over, folks. We look forward to Easter morning and Jesus' resurrection from the dead. And then again next Sunday, 10 a.m. Pacific time, as we gather as an extended community to celebrate Christ's resurrection from the dead. Until that time comes, I pray that you would keep safe, keep well, and that we would stay connected as a community through the whatever means that is available. Stay tuned to our Facebook page as we continue to put things up during the course of the week. But we have to end as we always do, as an extended family and a congregation. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God's blessings. We will see you Thursday evening for Maundy Thursday.
Thank you.